CME, which is having creditors accredited, thanks to a photo for that. And the talk is to be delivered by Dr. Ranjith S Nair, Digari Doctor. He is the Chief Orthopedic Surgeon in Apollo Hospital, and he is heading the Department of Orthopedics over there. Just to brief about him, he has graduated from the prestigious Medical College in Trivandrum back in Kerala, and even the postgraduate also from there. He carries with him the rich experience which he has incurred by working with senior consultants in different parts of India, and has mastered the technique of arthroscopy and joint replacement. Since 2011, that is for the past 6 years, he is there with Apollo, and he is sitting on with Apollo, and he has grown to the level that he is heading the team of Apollo for orthopedics. Today, the topic he would like to share with us is our arthroscopic experience in Oman. So as I told, since it is already 9:45, I won't take much of your time. Handing over the dice to Doctor.
Good evening to all, and thanks Niaz for that nice introduction. I think I'll go. At the outset, I would like to welcome you all to this wonderful evening, where the topic is nothing new. I am just focusing on our experience in scopies, which we have done over the last 6 years, and what we have gained, some knowledge I would like to share with you. And towards the end of the session, I think we can have an open discussion if there is anything, any points from which I would like to learn from you also, which would be helpful for me. Things not opening. So this today's topic regarding arthroscopy, as Niaz has mentioned, this is where I work with Apollo Hospital's Muscat. I've been working with them from 2011 onwards, so still continuing there. So I like the working atmosphere there. That's the reason why I'm still there. This is where this is located in Alhambra, in Muscat, in the city itself. So we engage with a lot of patients every day. Whether it shows a small snapshot of what is happening in the hospital almost every day. So, this started as a small medical center in 2006, which is upgraded to a medical center in 2007. And right now, we are gradually increased to telemedicine facilities, and I can proudly say that in the city of Muscat, we are one of the leading centers doing maximum number of orthopedics, including knee replacements, knee scopies. So we are standing tall among a lot of private hospitals. I mean, we cannot compare with the other hospitals because the quality is much higher. But among private hospitals, we are one of the best in volumes. And we have a dedicated knee replacement program. We have over 15 visiting consultants coming from Apollo India, where they cater to difficult patients. If you get a patient who we find we cannot deal comfortably, then that's with the help of consultants from Apollo India, where they visit us every 3 months, 4 months, like that. And we have instituted our laboratory, and recently we renovated our operation theater, and the ministry who came for inspection, we told us one of the best they have seen. So it is an expanded access emergency, we have a dedicated CT scan, MRI, digital X-rays, consultation suits, ICU, and we have two operation theaters for this fund. We have almost dedicated fully to orthopedics only, and I am so particular that I don't give that to anybody else. So that is why, because as orthopedics we are very particular about sterile techniques, so one of these especially for orthopedics. So having said this, I will come to this, my topic proper. God changes the golden rule of life, we have changed from fixed phones to mobile phones, we have changed from transported systems. So change is going to happen. It's going to happen in the future also. So similarly in orthopedic surgery, the change happened is from open techniques to closed arthroscopic techniques. So what is so great about this arthroscopy? I'll be dealing with this topic in under these headings, but it's a small history which we all should know, because we should know some great stuff that lots of works behind this arthroscopy. Some basic parts of arthroscopy, indications, contraindications, and of course it has got complications which I will be sharing, our own complications and which we have learned from literature also. And finally, small statistics which have gathered over the last 6 years. So when I was learning arthroscopy back in my post-graduation days, we had a consultant who used to take everything in a lighter sense. So he used to explain what is arthroscopy. It is actually came from a Greek word, arthro means joint and scopy means looking into. So he used to explain in such a way that it literally means, it can be compared to as if you are looking into a room through a keyhole without opening the door. So what is the advantage of looking through a keyhole without opening the door? He used to explain laughing that you will be able to enjoy whatever is happening inside the room, be able to see whatever is happening without disturbing the inside atmosphere. So how he used to compare with arthroscopy is that, so keyhole is arthroscopy and opening the door is open surgery. So once you open the door, that means once you go for an open surgery, you will be naturally disturbing the soft tissue, vascularity. So all these limitations can be overcome by arthroscopy. Having said that, it is not a hard and fast rule. There are certain conditions where you have to go for an open surgery itself. But this is how we used to explain. So even after so many years, this thing, it is inside my mind. So I thought I should share with you. So it literally means looking at a joint simply as you see a room through a keyhole without opening the doors. So coming to the history, this professor Takagi from Tokyo has been traditionally credited for performing the first arthroscopy. He comes from the East, so everywhere there will be naturally some form of controversy. So here again we have a controversy, like recently it was discovered that somebody from the West has already done that before. So we exactly don't know. Actually we don't know who has done it first, but right now we don't care who has done, we are still continuing with the work. But the most important works of arthroscopy came in early 1920s by Jürgen Buscher. He used mainly for diagnostic purposes. So that means he used to put in the arthroscope, he used to find out the cause, then he may have opted for open surgeries. So that is what we invented. But the masters in arthroscopy was Masaki Watanabe. He was the first who had done interventional surgeries. He used to do a lot of meniscal surgeries, and he is regarded as the founder of modern arthroscopy. So the first operating arthroscope was joined in the Watanabe and his men. And together they produced high quality intraocular photography. And over the years, when technology developed, the field of arthroscopy also developed. So right now we are in a good period of performing arthroscopies. So the technique of arthroscopy includes introducing a scope through a small tube that contains optical fibers, and through small incisions, that is the highlight of the scope, and is connected to a video camera, and the interior joint can be seen through a television monitor. And the size of the scope of the tube which you are using varies from joint to joint. So coming to this indication, what are the joints being scoped? Most commonly joint to be scoped is the knee, followed by the shoulder. But there are other indications like wrist can be scoped, ankle and elbow is not that much, but it has been done in some Asian countries. But knee and shoulder are the most commonly scoped joints. So in knee, it is mainly done for what we can call diagnostic meniscal injuries, cyst, ligament reconstruction, loose body recoil, osteochondritis, and actually the indications are increasing day by day. Hip can also be tried for labral injuries. Ankle we should do for this loose body recoil, sinovectin is deep right well. And shoulder, as the second most common joint to be scoped, is mainly done for rotator cuff repairs, loose bodies, for ligament injuries. I think it is done in the West. I am not sure whether anybody does it in India. So, other than doctors who benefit from arthroscopy, like performing surgery, who are those at risk of getting these injuries? One is this sports person, especially this football injuries. It's very common in Oman because football is a passion here. We get a lot of patients who are professional football, non-professional football players having sustained injuries to the knee. And other thing is the shoulder. We see in overhead, those who are using overhead activities, especially cricket players, and those who use accuracy in health clubs, they usually sustain shoulder injuries. And these are the common things we get in places like rugby or Indian football, all forms of contact sports. And this part of the world, India used to get a lot of road-running accidents also, where they had injuries associated with the practice. But in this part of the world, since accidents are fatal, and the ligament injuries are not that common, which I've seen. So coming to the instrumentation, it consists of an arthroscopy unit, a fiber electrode, and a television monitor. So, and that's the basics. And other instruments include which is a probe, a scissors, a basket, which varies from surgery to surgery. And the most important is the irrigation system. So this is how a probe looks like. It is called as arthroscopy sixth finger. Because with a tiny incision, normally we cannot put in our finger, so we usually put the probe to feel. So over gradually over a couple of years, you start getting the feel. Maybe I use the probe itself. And the second thing is a basket punch we use for meniscal tears, for meniscal balancing. And these are chambers we use for debridement, and if it is a meniscus which cannot be repaired, we usually sort to this meniscectomy for using the chambers. And fourth, this one is the monitor unit, which I consider one of the most important thing in arthroscopy because it helps in simply documenting. Because this is an era of medical litigation, medical cases are developing day by day. So we usually document each and everything what is happening because some of the patients who find after surgery may come back after 6 months till then, the pain is still there, you are not done anything till then. So this sort of documentation will help you and it will help to convince the patient also that most of the pain can be like psychosomatic. So this is how the equipment is assembled. You can skip that. So coming to this, if you get a patient for arthroscopy, I believe mainly the knee because we are mainly doing the knee scope. Most important is the history and the nature of the injury. What we naturally get is a twisting injury to the knee while playing football or jumping from a small height of the knee gets twisted. And typical tests like Lagman test is a test by which we test the angular instability of the joint. If we suspect ligament injury, straightaway we can go for a scopy itself. But since documentation is important in this era, you should go for an MRI. Because the MRI is the gold standard. And MRI, having said 1.5 Tesla MRI is 0.3 Tesla is not good for seeing a ligament injury or a meniscal injury. And if you have a 3 Tesla, it is well and good, it is actually luxury. But we have 1.5 Tesla, which shows most of the meniscal tears or ligament injuries, and we have a dedicated team of radiographers, 3 radiographers who are doing a very good job who are helping us in picking up even small injuries, especially cortical defects. And after seeing an MRI, we should explain the procedure to the patient. That is very important because having said that arthroscopy is a tiny incision procedure, I mean, you should not be giving the false impression to the patient that after around what small procedure, you will be able to walk around comfortably. So we usually expect the procedure fully to the patient that 2 days they will be in hospital, second day onwards only they will start physiotherapy. It is a complete knee package we usually expect fully to the patient, then only written consent by which we expect all possible complications which we commonly see like knee stiffness, extension lag, or rare case we have to have DVT also. So all these things we will expect the patient, get it signed, then only we will take him up for the surgery. So once the patient inside for surgery, what we generally practice is patient will get admitted only on the morning of surgery in order to want a lot of patient. I usually prefer spinal anesthesia, but some of the patients they have breathing phobias, so the spinal anesthesia is not going to work on them. So they want some form of general anesthesia. Why I prefer spinal anesthesia is during the procedure itself, I make a habit of explaining to the patient, showing to the monitor that this injury is there, this is what has been done, which helps me and which helps to gain the confidence also, and it helps a lot during rehabilitation. Otherwise, if a patient is under GA, going back to the room explaining is quite difficult. So we usually perform under spinal anesthesia, and shoulder we perform under regional wounds. And for the knee, the positioning is what we this is what we usually use in our hospital. The position for the knee scopes and this is for the ACL hyperflexion. This can also be used, but our hospital has the system already. This is how it looks like after the patient is laid and after the incision is in mouth. And this is the two positions we use for shoulder. I usually prefer this knee chair position because it looks like a person has seen a knee. So I usually prefer knee chair for shoulder because it gives me the anatomical orientation. But one of the consultants who comes to us from India, he prefers exactly like this position. I always get confused because the whole joint has to look like this anatomical orientation. So it varies from surgeon to surgeon what they prefer. So coming a little bit, because the knee cases are maximum, just a small thing about the knee, what we do, this is the anatomy of the knee. This is the femur, this is the tibia, and this is the meniscus, and this is the ACL, which is the coxal and butter most of the time. And this is the two ligaments, the collateral ligament injuries, which can also be seen along with ACL injuries. In that case, we usually go for a prolonged rehabilitation rather than an acute repair. So we mainly focus on ACL. PCL injuries, used to get following road traffic accidents or fall from heights, but here in football injuries or contact sport injuries, where PCL tears, I don't know the exact reason, I have not seen that commonly compared to ACL. If you get around 100 ACLs, maybe 2 PCLs, that is the ratio which we are seeing. For ACL, once it is sewn, we usually go for a reconstruction only, because there is no chance to repair. So the preferred grafts, I usually go for hamstring. We use the semitendinosus and the bracelets, and if you get a good lengthy graft, then we usually take only one either SEO bracelet, and we use to triple it and put it inside. Bone metal alone is also used, but in this part of the world where the brain habits involves healing, so most patients will have a host of pain. So I don't prefer this CTD unless we don't have a choice. We have done BJD before because a patient who had a previous surgery, he fully recovered, he went again and prayed. Again, his ligament got ruptured. So the opposite knee hamstring was harvested. Again, surgery done. His confidence was increasing, so he again recovered and prayed. Again, he got ruptured. So third time he had to opt for BJD. And after that, I have not seen him. Either his graft is still in that or he has gone to somewhere else. And this is the usual graft side, and this is how it looks like once we harvest the hamstring. And this can be stripped through the small tiny incision itself using a tendon stripper. It's a beautiful instrument which cuts the ligament and that musculoskeletal junction. And regarding once you take out this graft, the fixation, I usually prefer for proximal femoral side, either an endobutton or a tightrope, and femoral side. I have tried all other things, through post, staples, nothing, but I found this more convenient, more time friendly for me. And this proximal also, tightrope we have used, this is small button lengthening, endo button or pull ups, everything works the same principle. But only thing is, if you are using a DTV, you will not be able to use a tightrope, you have to go for a screw on both sides. So I generally go for a screw bias from the tibia and button, and the results are quite good for me. So I have not thought of changing it. These are some of the surgical, we usually allow documentation to give the patient CV also, that all the photos, all the significant photos, and a full video of the surgery. So these are some of the photos we took. This is a normal meniscus, and this is how a total meniscus looks like. And once you probe it, this is a probe which goes in and see, although it looks like it is in here, once you probe it, you will see the extension of it there. And depending upon the site of the meniscal tear and whether it is viable, we go for either meniscal repair or meniscectomy. Meniscal repair, as you know, meniscus is a vascular structure which can be divided into three parts depending upon vascularity. If the tear is in a vascular area, we go for meniscal surgery. But having said that, I always say to the patient, reoperation rates after a meniscal surgery is a bit high. So even if you go for a meniscal surgery, you don't need to come for the game pain and you may have to resort for meniscectomy, partial meniscectomy and balancing. So nowadays most of the consultants, they go straight for meniscectomy rather than trying meniscal repair, unless the patient is wanting to do so. We have an associate who is a German consultant who comes from Germany who performs such cases. He also has some sort of bilateral meniscal. So it is happening globally, that's what I mean. He initially used to have a lot of meniscal repairs, but after 2 years, 3 years, he is still having complaints. So there is also a meniscectomy. So meniscal repairs, I know if the patient is willing to sign a consent, then the chances of recovery rates are high. If he is not willing, then we should go for partial meniscectomy. And the main, I just show a small video which we took during this. So this will show how clearly we can see the joint. This is how we see when we put in a scope. This will be the patella, and this is the femur. We are into the patellofemoral joint. And this is the flap of the meniscus which is lying in the patellofemoral joint, which can be beautifully seen during this OP procedure. Otherwise, in an open procedure, it will be very difficult to access this area and get back to the meniscus. So, the portion of meniscus has got torn from this part and is gone into the patellofemoral joint. So, this we had to do over a partial meniscectomy and balancing. And lately, we have started doing. This is how we prepare the ACL side. This is the partial ACL which has been torn up. So, clearing up that torn ACL and after harvesting graft, we actually pull up. I just show how the graft goes up beautifully. So, it will give a lot of satisfaction for the surgeon and I believe for the patient also. This is how we actually pull up that new ACL which we harvest from the hamstring. Antibody system will be useful because it's strong, it is not to cut through. So once we have done the femoral tunnel and tibial tunnel, we pull it up through that tunnel. Yeah, this is the type that the endocutter is doing in. Just checking that length. Yeah, this is how that new ACL goes in. It goes to the post and actually the posterior corner of that femur and that endocutter is going in post and clips out the femur so that the graft stays in position. And we check that impingement also after that position. And this is how it looks like after everything has been done. The femoral side has been fixed with the endocutter and the tibial side has been fixed with the bioscope. We actually check the position and the most important thing we check is the impingement of the femur. Because if that is not being checked, post-operative is going to be a disaster. Because the patient is going to, once the pain and everything has gone, patient is going to move his knee, this graft is going to impinge against the femur and is going to for a venous rupture or a venous pain. So that is very important before we close the procedure. And lately we have actually started doing oats procedure also. The small video which I showed towards the last presentation. And just to show the advantages of the arthroscopy, the most important advantage is reduced post-op morbidity because as I said, the patient gets admitted in the morning and surgery is getting finished 1.5 hours. By evening, we'll start the patient physical therapy. We'll start healing. And second day, on accuracy physiotherapy, we make sure that he bends the knee at least 90 degrees and he walks as a walker and he breathes. And only if he's bending by 90 degrees and starts the walker support, then only he will discharge. Most commonly, most often the patient goes back in 48 hours. And so that is how the reduced postural morbidity comes into play. And of course, it is a smaller incision, which is cost really much, much better. Because this was how we used to previously look like, we go for an open surgery, and this is how it looks like in a post arthroscopy. Other advantages are because of less change, reduced hospital costs, and it helps improve diagnosis. Because as I told, even though MRIs are, pre-test MRIs have come, most of them, if it is not able to pick up, we usually go for a diagnosis group itself, which will clearly show and document also that what is the problem inside. Because in some of the cases, we need a synovial biopsy, because MRI may show only a synovitis. The reason may not be evident, so we usually go for a diagnosis group, take it as a synovial and send it for biopsy. And if we see some form of chronic synovitis, we just take a partial synovitis also, the same procedure. And it is easy for a renal procedure. As I told you, patient coming back after, we usually do after maybe 2 years for a small journal purpose, we are called upon our old operative patients to have a small renal procedure for how our ACL grafts look like. For such renal procedures, scope is 2 weeks ago, that's just the outpatient procedure. And as I showed in the video, we can easily access most of the difficult corners of the joint. Because one of the process is to tell that using arthroscopy, you should be able to access all corners of the joint. If you are finding difficulty in doing any procedure, then stop it because there is something wrong, either with your portal placement or with your placement of the toe. So, usually if your scope is going well, you should be able to access all corners quite easily. And as I told before, documentation is one of the most important factor of you should keep all patients, either with CD copy, we expect them during the procedure before discharge also, so that there is no doubt in their minds what has been done. Because usually what happens is once the patient is out of the hospital, they should go for doctor shopping. So there is nothing, if they are not clear about what has been done to their joint, then it is not good. Once they come back, if they have some doubt in their mind, then it is very difficult to convince them back. So documentation is one of the most important. Having said all the disadvantages, has got a lot of disadvantages also, and having some advantages. Disadvantages are that we've got a learning curve. It is not as easy, you need to be with a consultant doing scopy regularly. It takes maybe 1-2 years to have a feel of the joint. Because during our postgraduate studies, we used to give us the pumpkin to catch the seeds for giving the triangulation. Because your eyes will be on the monitor and your hands will be using the procedure. That hand-eye coordination has to be there. And triangulation has to be there, so it will take some time. And it needs good temperament because it is a magnified view which you are seeing. If you are just in a wrong place, maybe by 1 centimeter, the entire view is going to change. And you will literally be lost in the joint. You will not be able to know where you are. So it needs a good temperament too. And of course, expensive equipment are there. And I think that management is helping us in that. So we right now equipment wise we don't have any issues. And coming to the complications. So this picture is not at all an exaggeration. It has happened because usually in our OPD practice you will post a patient for surgery and you will run to your OPD to see the OPD patients and the anesthetist will give them anesthesia, maybe GE and block. And once you come to the theater, you're not sure which leg it is wrong. So under anesthesia, all ligaments are going to relax. You will not be able to clinically assess which leg. So even though in OPD procedure you have written which leg to be operated, I make sure from our part before the patient is sent to the theater, they have to mark the leg, which leg to be operated. And consultant comes to us from India, he makes sure that he marks other leg also, that not this leg. So he marks both legs. This is the leg to be operated. This complication has happened, that wrong leg operation. So if such a thing happens, it is going to be a disaster. You won't be able to do an answer to the patient why you operated on the wrong leg. So this is usually for all patients I use tourniquet. For shoulder, there is no way to use tourniquet, and we usually go for hypotensive anesthesia and high impact pressure because that will reduce the bleeding. And in stone break case, luckily nothing has happened for me till now. So it has been recorded in the reflexes, so I thought I should share it. So these are the some things once you finish the procedure or once before the procedure, a lot of patients ask. Like how long should I take rest? And most of them are, even though they are not professional players, they are not they enjoy playing. So the main question is not like when can I go back to work. The main question will be when can I go back to play. So that is a question I face a lot. So and this is the end of the sporting career. For this thing, usually for the rest, I advise that 2 days in hospital they have to have a dedicated rest and physiotherapy. Second day onwards they will start walking. 2 weeks if they do regular exercise, knee bending, everything, they should be able to do all normal activities except driving, climbing up and down steps, and leg squatting. Driving and climbing we usually allow after 3 weeks only once they have got all the proper range of movements and proprioception. Usually after surgery the proprioception is the thing which can take some time. So driving is not something that is advisable. And usually most of the patients after 4 weeks when they come back they are comfortable, they only little bit of extension lag in there and some of the patients that will also go away with physiotherapy and regular exercise. And most important question is will I be able to play, go to my playground back? For this I usually give the examples of some of the external policies. They are not going to come back after major knee surgeries. Tiger hooks, yeah, ACL repair with the bone, BGT graft, and he has come back. So not only in gold, there are other people who have come back in active sports after arthroscopy. So I usually give them the examples whom they know most. So usually in this part of the world, they may not know such a symptom earlier in our Tiger hooks, but this man they definitely know. So he has also had a short arthroscopy and he's also back. So why not? Doing regular exercise, regular physiotherapy, applying to all things, they cannot go back to the academic life. Having said that, surgery is important, but similar or much more important is rehabilitation, which is usually the difference between the average outcome and excellent clinical outcome. Because it needs a high degree of motivation. Usually, what happens is following an arthroscopy surgery after 2 weeks, the patient will have pain free, they will be able to normally do all the activities. So they will think why I should go for a rehab, why I should go for a knee physiotherapy, which is a wrong perception. Because for that, only for that purpose I make sure that I see all patients, personally I see all patients in 2 weeks time of the surgery. Because that is the time when they slip out of our hands and go for the normal activities. In that case, their knee is not going to be normal. Usual reality is although it takes around 6 months, at least 2 months they need dedicated physiotherapy for strengthening this knee. And right now actually we are sending patients to SQ rehab center. They take up patients following ACL and they are doing rehabilitation. And we have a dedicated physiotherapist extensively for post-operative care too. They say they take care of the patient right from the bed itself. Once they come back after surgery, they make sure on the second day they bend the knee to 90 degrees. They walk, they do the SLR, they make sure everything is done. And once after discharge, we send them to Washington. If it is a local patient, we send them to ASQ, then Washington. And if it is an expat, we ask them to come back to us. And this is what we usually do. The second day onwards, we mobilize full wheelchair crutches. We usually give a brace and a walker support. Initially, ice packs, and we can be done. Little bit of swelling on the supramedullary area is common after surgery. I always advise don't aspirate because it is not doing any help by aspirating that swelling. And usually 6 months is the one time, 6 to 9 months of the time, usually 6 months is the time I give for the patient to go back to active sports. So most of the patients ask, say, I don't have a problem, why should I go for physiotherapy? This is the answer for them because 3 months post is often called as a transition time because that is the time in this, because they are just introduced there. just a small bifurcation at the joint. So just as we need time to adapt to new environment, this new aircraft has to adapt. It's also got its own time to adapt to this new environment. So that is what we need in this physiotherapy, knee strengthening. And especially after cold, this knee surgery, the hand strengthening, the quadriceps muscle, they go for weakness. That is our goal. So this quadriceps has also to be regained. So these are the things we gain during postural rehabilitation. So this is mainly what we do in this one, our knee surgeries. And a small word regarding small joint arthroscopies. Ankle we do with the help of a consultant coming from India and also German consultant. We usually go for this one, chronic synovitis, synovial biopsy, and some one time we have done this small loose body recovery also. Hip joint, we have done for the labral tears, but the impingement system personally I have not had it. Wrist joint, EFCC tears can be done, and usually once we go for a diagnoscopy and then it will end up in a knee open procedure itself if you have to go for a knee repair. These are the things we do in our center for the years. For the last 6 years we have been gradually doing all the cases. So I thought I should just mention regarding some of the statistics. Like we started from 2011 onwards, the number of cases, the volume has been increasing. Luckily, right now I think we have done more than 1,000 cases of the ACLs alone. We are only maybe less than the major complication. Minor things can happen, but they are already resolved. The major complication has been resolved. Like one patient had thrombosis virus, one patient had screw infection, he had a remove it, and one patient had a graft rupture. So all those things have been sorted out. So luckily, the volumes have been increasing. As years are going by, and this is our personal ACL, as I told, becomes the main bread and butter. Majority of the patients comes to the ACL tear with the meniscus, and next is the pure meniscus injury and shoulders and revision. And added to this, and recently we have started giving this for a over meniscal injury, we see only meniscal regeneration. We have started giving periodic rich plasma, so PRP, when which they take the patients on blood centrifuge and theatricism and give it a fresh short of ERP to the meniscus, which is helping to regenerate the meniscus. That's what they are telling, and also in small initiatives away also. ERP is very good. And we are starting using this osteochondral transfer system for cartilage defects, sports procedures. That is also in our armamentarium now. And for as I told, for a joint purpose, we have been just reviewing our last cases, and this is what we saw. We are just taking up the age groups which we did this, and this is what we saw. Majority of the age groups fall between 25 and 35. 25-35 is a young, active, income earning population. They are going to, not going to work because of any injury, it is not doing good. So it becomes a social responsibility also to give them a good knee back for doing surgery. So in that case, I think what I have shifted to patients, most of the patients, what they happen is they actually keep along that injured knee. That is actually doing more damage, because once the ligament is injured, it will be extra pressure on the soft cartilage, and they invariably go for early work. So the intercessory entirely cannot handle it in a small arthroscopy procedure. You have to go for a major surgery. Because if it is an arthritic knee, whatever you do for a ACL, the patient is going to have a pain post-operatively. And because initially during our much enthusiastic time, we used to do all ACL surgeries, irrelevant whether they had a memory or not. So post of all, we found out that those patients who did go and early away, the symptoms did not improve after surgery. So earlier, initially, acute injury, we actually give them rest for 4 weeks, then only take up for surgery, but it has to be done at the earliest. So, having seen that this percentage, we just reviewed the major cause of injury. Major cause of injury was mostly football related. So, 2 years back, we had one meeting in the Muscat ministry, everybody was there. They were just reviewing their challenges also. They also found that football injury was the major cause of these knee ligament injuries. So their one approach was to do that maybe in future, maybe, we don't know. Like they give physical components doing all these procedures, especially when we are not as an orthopedic department, we have a specialty clinic program. It is a well-structured program. It involves in-house orthopedics. I would say I head the department of orthopedics. I have two more doctors with me, two more in-house doctors who also do all these cases. And we have an anesthesia department, nursing, physiotherapy department, so two of them are dedicated for our most of the patients. And we do get help from all over India also. So it is in fact a teamwork. And there are a lot of people whom we don't recognize, like in order to talk people in the administration, marketing, front office, anesthesia technicians, they also help, and pharmacy. So all of them, it makes a good team to have such a clinic program running, which have been helping us a lot. Such volumes. And I have noted everyone plays a part because if one of them does not fit it in place, then everything is going to shake. So, from 2011, we have come a long way. We started with some diagnosis, endoscopy, meniscal balancing, meniscal repair, ACL reconstruction. Then we did revision ACL, again, revision ACL we have done. And from because the patients have lost both their hands, we did stallograph. Because they didn't want a DVD. And lately, in 6 months, we started using Morse procedure. Morse procedure, somebody is not aware, the cartilage is damaged. We harvest fresh cartilage from a non arthritic surface of the joint and put it inside that damaged part, by which then we will regenerate again and show the scopes. Just also, and then just coming to the last part of the presentation, I think I'll just show a bit. This was the patient we did last time. He was having a big cartilage defect in the articulating surface of the femur. So he was having severe pain, he was not able to bend his knee or sort of issues. So we opted for an odd procedure by which what we do is we remove that cartilage rod and we make two peg holes in that affected part. We freshen that area, we harvest new cartilage from non-articulating part, we should take from the trochlear area and we fill it. So this is the whole procedure and this patient had got an ACL care also. So his rehabilitation, we had to personally see how he is doing because in such cases, weight bearing is not allowed. Because I do not want him to come back with a loose body. Although it is snugly fit, I was not prepared to take this. So he was given complete non-weight bearing physiotherapy for patient release. And he is doing well now. His pain has gone and friction is gone. So this is one of the good patients we had following course. So this is also very good now for cartilage defects. And of course the future looks bright because we are planning to publish all this because three journals are the pipeline is almost waiting for the approval and we are planning a couple of them in their initial stages and we are planning to initiate more hip and annual studies. And of course, one of the agenda for the last moment which I will discuss is to have outreach clinics to have different parts of Oman. So, this is from my side. I hope I didn't bore you down. So, because I am a person who believes in teamwork. So, thank you all for your patient hearing, and I would like to thank Dr. Shai, who was here with the marketing department. Mr. Niyas was there for hosting this event. And for personally, all of you have come here for hearings. And before finishing, is there anything that I can clear other than, is there anything if you are wanting to clear, other than orthopedics, also, is there anything from hospital side? Or if you want to add something, please feel free.
Hello, I'm Dr. Hilal. was done along with the consultant from India, because that time we had to fix it. And second time actually he opted because he had a large medicine cyst also along with that. So we actually had to remove, because in such case we had to be very careful about that cartilage. So we actually balanced the meniscus and ligament we actually maintained for conservative management. So we are doing immediate cases.
Thank you. In the isolated PCL injuries, what's your treatment of the joints actually?
Isolated PCL, first of all, acetonics quite rare. In India, we used to get polyurethric accidents. What we usually do is we get the posterior drawers, frankly positive, and if it is a, then we have to go for a repair. We usually go for a hamstring and we need a 70 degree scope. We commonly use 30 degree scope for ACLs. For we need a 70 degree scope, and for fixation, I usually go for a posterior mini open, fix it. And anteriorly to the kidney and posteriorly come back to the kidney. We use that Arthrex system.
Okay, in injuries like OACL, PCL, and all, do you prefer to go repair PCL or filter? Just go for ACL?
Both can actually go for ACL.
Okay.
And follow the rehabilitation, and I usually tell the patient that they may need a second surgery, but most of them they don't come back. Because for them, once the ACL is intact for the surgery, they will be able to manage most of the
intraarticular and arthroscopy assisted intraarticular fracture fixations. Do you know that?
I like tibial tubercle?
Yeah. I mean tibial tubercle as well as tibial plateau.
Tibial plateau we have not done here. Tibial tubercle we have done once. But I mean that arthroscopy assisted only. You have to go for a open assisted only, yeah. But that is also not very common here. I think I have done only one or two. I mean, do you get such cases here? Just out of curiosity.
No, no, I'm asking. Since you're doing a lot of arthroscopy cases, do you
arthroscopy assisted fracture fixation we do, and but now I think 5 years maximum, 2 or 3 years.
Okay. Thank you, doctor.
Any more doubts? Clarifications? Anyone?
Thank you so much, doctor. And